This video is maybe the first in a series, but right now it's the first one which kind of sets the tone for our latest thinking in YouTube movies for trains. And so let me just give you a quick overview of what you're going to find in the video. First of all, there are two movie clips. In the first one, the train will be operated automatically in both the forward and reverse direction. In the second one, the train is set to run forward only, but I activated the ringing bell and put it up to speed. It's kind of interesting. And the next, probably seven are still photographs that I'll just describe briefly, but they're all the engine and the individual cars that comprise the equipment you see on the track. Track being standard gauge, the locomotive being an American Flyer Brass Piper. Some data about the track. I chose to run the 6-foot diameter K-line track for the curves, and on the straights I have just Lionel pre-war straight sections. The switch with the siding on it is by American Flyer. To power the train, I used our train troll, which is a device I designed myself, and it was designed to run trains via computer and also to do sequencing. You can see it in some of our other movies where we demonstrated it with O-gauge trains. I'm using it to control, start, stop the train and set its speed using an infrared control that's part of it. The accessories you see trackside are a mix of Lionel and American Flyer, mostly Lionel. And last but not least, the camera was a Nikon D3100, which I had mounted on a tripod. The layout takes up most of a fairly large room, so I had to be careful where I put everything. But I think at the end, hopefully you like what you see, and we can maybe do some more like this. In the first part of this movie clip, I'm going to demonstrate the remote reverse for this American Flyer set. Then I'm going to pause the video, and I'm going to put it forward only and work the ringing bell. But first, let's see if we can get this guy to move using our train troll, which you see on the right-hand side of the picture. And I'm working the infrared remote control from back where I have the camera. And there it went backwards. And let's see if we can get it to go forward. Seems to be doing a nice job. See if we can slow down a bit. And backwards one more time. I'm going to bring it to a halt again. And I'm going to stop the video momentarily. In the last part of this video, I turned off the remote reverse and activated the ringing bell. Many of these American Flyer locomotives have ringing bells in standard gauge as well as in O-gauge. And they're kind of interesting. This is a favorite feature of my wife's. So let's run a few laps with the ringing bell and see what it sounds like. This is a very smooth running locomotive, as you can see. They have a nice powerful motor, and this one's capable of actually running from my home-built train controller, which produces about 60 watts to the track. The 392 isn't quite so happy with this, but the American Flyer motors are very efficient. Let's give it a little more speed. Thank you. can see it really steps out, and we'll bring it to a nice slow halt down at the end of the track. So thank you for watching the video. Hope you enjoyed it. Perhaps we can conjure up some more, maybe with some operating accessories, if we can garner up a little more power in our system. So now that the operating excitement is over, here are some still photos of all the rolling stock you see on the track. First and foremost, of course, is this American Flyer 4696, known as the Brass Piper. And this particular one has a Vanderbilt tender, which is an oil tender. The one shown here is restored, nicely restored. So it's all refurbished and in great running order. It features what's called remote distant reverse. It reverses when the engine is stopped or loses power. And it also has a ringing bell. And of course, you saw both of those in operation. Immediately behind the locomotive is a number 4006 Red Hopper car. This has two handles on the opposite side that release the doors at the bottom of the hopper in case you want to put a load in and dump it. And this one shows evidence inside that somebody had indeed done that. Don't know why, I don't know what you put inside, but nonetheless, it's possible. It has been done. And this is one of the more difficult cars to find in the American Flyer Freight Series. It's about 14 inches long, so it's a pretty good size. Next in line is a number 4023 log car. These are pretty typical, but they're nice, they're colorful, and it fits in nicely with the cars I had on track. Another fairly hard to find and desirable freight car is the American Flyer number 4010 tank car. This particular one has a blue base and a yellow tank. There's some fairly rare varieties of this car. This one's more common. And even though it's beat up, it's still such a rare car that you really don't want to restore it. The last car actually running around the track is a number 4021 red caboose, actually a two-tone red, and the interior is illuminated. Not much to say about it, except it typically is the end of the set. And again, it's about 14 inches long. American Flyer cars are nicely detailed and a little more slender in proportion than the larger 200 series Lionel freights. So I am very fond of them. They make very attractive standard gauge trains. Here's one of two cars I decided to just set aside on the siding because I thought train would look more exciting with the first ones that you've already seen. And this one is a car number 4018, known as an automobile car. I'm not sure why, but I guess at some point they put automobiles in them. So there it is. To me, it looks more like a box car. It's a cream and blue, pretty attractive looking car, and fairly common among American Flyer freight cars. So, holding up the end is a stock car. This is a number 4020 in two-tone blue. The roof has probably seen better days, but again, these are hard to find, so when I saw it, I thought it was just appropriate to buy it. So, this is all the rolling stock that I have. Right behind this car, you can see an Ives water tower, which is appropriate for the freight set. So this being the last of the cars, just a comment that this particular movie was made using some of our latest techniques, which included the use of Microsoft PowerPoint. And in an upcoming two-part video series, you'll see some details about how we have produce these movies, what they look like, the equipment we've used, and some of the techniques. So I hope you've enjoyed this video, and hopefully we can move forward with some more as time progresses. Thanks for looking.